and Gray in the gold trunks, Blair in the red trunks, referee Reggie Parks. And Blair circles his man, watches him, collar and elbow, and it's Gray into the ring ropes. Clean break by Blair, backs away. Once again, they lock up collar and elbow. And it was a good counter that time by Blair as Gray shot for a leg. Blair countered him very nicely in a good ride. Good ride on Gray. Gray trying to escape, trying to sit up. Blair keeps the ride going into a three-quarter Nelson. Has a three-quarter Nelson. Partial hook on the leg. He's got the pin. He's got the pin. And doggone near record time, an outstanding victory. And wait a minute. Gray, frustrated and angered over that quick pin, attacking Blair from behind, and Blair explodes on him. Blair. And I don't blame Blair one bit in the world. Hold on just a second. And there's the man who was identified to me as the Green Kendo schedule, as I said earlier, in a standby match out here after Brian Blair now. And
Championship Wrestling. I'm Gordon Soley. Barber's Take 5 this week is most interesting. Stay tuned for that. Right now, however, I want to talk to Brian Blair, because what you saw occurred here on Championship Wrestling 82 last week. And Mongoose Draper later came to me and even apologized for his tactics, from the standpoint that he said that this was something that he had to settle with Brian Blair once and for all. And made this statement, of course, that you were running from him. And I've never known you to run from anybody.
Well, that's right, Gordon. I never have run from anybody, and I'm not going to start right now. If he wants to wrestle, I'm ready to wrestle him face to face. He's got something on his chest he wants to get off. Well, let him get it off, because I'm ready to wrestle him right now.
And we're going to be seeing that match right here on television in just a moment. But, Brian, let me just say this, in deference to everybody concerned in this situation. I did some checking during this past week, and his primary bone of contention with you concerns a dressing room in Louisiana, and he got a chair wrapped around his head, Brian.
Well, you know, Gordon, I guess maybe I got a little out of control and kind of took things in my own hand, but he thought it was a real joke, taking a young man, just won the Nationals out of high school, came in there to try to wrestle, be a professional wrestler. He based his whole career on it. He's teaching school right now because Derek Draper broke his leg. And it did kind of upset me, and I guess I went a little overboard. And if he wants to continue what happened, well, that's up to him. That's fine with me.
Well, okay, but I'll tell you what. We're going to see Brian Blair and Mongoose Draper in the ring. We've got a host of great matches, including a Florida TV championship coming up. Also, as I said, Barber's Take 5 involving the Tampa Bay Buccaneers and the professional wrestlers. A lot of great matches, so by all means do stay tuned for this. And we will be back with Brian Blair versus Mongoose Draper right after we pause for these words.
This match will one fall with a 10-minute time limit from Tampa, Florida, weighing in at 226 pounds, Brian Blair. His opponent from California, weighing 261 pounds, Derek the Mongoose Draper.
Okay, Derek Draper moving out against Brian Blair. Both men very eager to get into this fray, and they meet head-on, collar and elbow. Both men trying to gain some leverage, some balance advantage here, and it is Blair with a good reversal by Draper. Reversal by Blair again, and it's Draper. Knee to the midsection, a snap mare. Blair caught in the front face. Both men caught now, and it is... Draper tried to go to an inside cradle, blocked by Blair. Blair into a lateral press. And into the ropes now, referee Tommy Young, an outstanding NWA troubleshooting referee, breaking it up very cleanly as they roll away from the ropes, back into action, and they're up against the turnbuckle. Tell you what, you talk about intensity. You can feel it between these two. And Draper wasting no time. Forearms, and it's Blair firing back. Blair catches him again, rocks Draper, and Draper steps backward that time. And the referee warning both men about fists. Brian Blair and Derek Draper settling a long-standing feud between these two, or attempting to settle it at this point. Draper using that forearm, keeping the right arm of Blair trapped. Now Blair retaliates. Blair back, and the forearms are very effective here as Draper again is staggered. Tommy Young telling him to get in there and wrestle, and These men are hard-pressed now to even think about rules and regulations. That's increasingly obvious. Knee lift by Draper that puts Blair back to the canvas. Blair back on his feet. Blair, forearms to the midsection, forearms again. Both men in the peak of physical condition. And again, you can see Blair. Perhaps good block. And Blair tried to bring him up for a slam. Good block by Draper. Blair then countered, went into an inside cradle of counter by Draper again. Draper now, once again, these men almost at a stalemate position. So play by Brian Blair has Draper back to the canvas now. Draper cinching down on that headlock. So Blair, hampered here, can't move like he would like to, I am sure. Back to their feet once again. Now it is Draper bullying Brian Blair back into the turnbuckle. Reversal by Blair. Blair leaning on him now. Referee Tommy Young trying to separate them. Even Blair taking a shot on the break. And Blair now with a series of forearms to the side of the jaw of Derek Draper. Draper down. And Blair stands ready. Draper misses with a wild swinging right hand, and it's Blair bringing him up. Blair has caught him. And Blair now beginning to take the edge here, a count of two by referee Tommy Young. Blair has him up, the airplane spin. Blair has him for the airplane spin. And Mr. Draper's challenge has been met right here. And that has to be all she wrote as Blair moves in, tries to get that variation of the Cobra on there. Ooh! The referee has Draper in desperation trying to break that Cobra. Grab hold. The referee smashed into the head of Brian Blair. Draper certainly holding an advantage at this particular point in time now with that side headlock. There's that stampede, and Blair is in trouble. Blair in trouble here as Derek Draper, an opportunist, seizing the opportunity with the referee sidelined, stunned as he crashed into the head of Brian Blair. And Draper now. Draper rides that knee into the middle of the back of Brian Blair. And Blair is down. Look at Blair trying to get back to his feet. The punishment that he is taking in gamely, trying to get back to his feet. Lots of inner drive here. Tremendous intestinal fortitude. Draper closes in, catches him again. Draper smashing away at the head of Brian Blair. And Blair, in a flare, fires back. Boy, and you talk about intensity these two have at the referee, trying to get it together in the corner. And trying to just get his eyes focused at this time. As Draper catches Blair once again. And Blair has taken unbelievable punishment. And still has the courage, the tenacity, and the power to fire back. And Blair, as a result of that collision with the referee, has certainly been lacerated here, and it is Blair continuing to battle on now. He has taken everything that Derek Draper had to offer and is firing back with even more. Caught him with a lariat coming off the rope. Blair down across the face of Derek Draper, and Draper, talk about conditioning, tenacity, intestinal fortitude. These, both of these men have it. I cannot take a thing away from either man, but Blair has certainly made a courageous return here, and a pair sixer erupting between these two. And the referee, naturally somewhat wary, and it is Blair now who that adrenaline is flowing, getting that second
That second burst of energy falling from way down, and the referee shoved to one side by Draper, as they would just as soon not have anybody. They'll battle this thing out right to the absolute bitter end. And they're in that corner again. The referee trying to separate them again. The referee... Wait a minute. The referee calling for the bell. The referee stopping this match. The referee stopping the match as it has gotten, obviously here, out of control on the part of both Brian Blair and Derek Draper. The referee has stopped the match. We'll get order restored and we'll be back. We'll be back in just a moment. Well, the situation between Derek Draper and Brian Blair obviously is a long way, in my opinion, from being settled at this point in time. JJ Dillon has joined me here at the desk with an announcement that certainly bears listening to.
Gordon Sully, I think it's an announcement that's going to startle the wrestling world. It may come as a surprise to many of you, but if you actually sit and think about it, it shouldn't. One might think that myself being in the posture of holding a contract with Kendo Nagasaki, the Black Ninja, that I'd be sitting on the top of the world. But you see, no successful man ever lets grass grow under his feet. Kendo Nagasaki is, above all else, a warrior. He's a man that's going to win a lot of matches. He's going to make me a lot of money. This thing has already started happening. But I can say, I always have my eyes open. A situation took place in this very ring 1 week ago when Kendo Nagasaki was facing Terry Allen. And in the course of this match, Jimmy Garvin came into the ring. He came into the ring with a degree of ferociousness, with pent-up rage. It was a determination and a mental commitment that one only finds in really a true champion. And these are the type of qualities that I must have, because I see in Jim Garvin a future world heavyweight champion. He's got something that a good coach can certainly recognize, but it's something that even a great coach cannot teach someone. You've either got it or you don't have it, and Jim Garvin certainly has it. I phoned Jim Garvin. He wasn't really excited about talking to me, but I said, look, let me talk to your attorney. Tom Smith, who represented Jim Garvin, is he's a very, very hard negotiator. This is probably the most lucrative contract in all of professional sports today. It's cost me a lot of money, but I feel that it's worth it. Jim Garvin has joined me here this morning with his attorney, Tom Smith. The contract is here. The negotiation is all, it's all done. It's actually the moment of the formal signing. The contract is here. I want the contract signed. And in so signing, the only thing I ask of Jim Garvin, that in the future with this signing, that he give me that same determination that he showed me last week, that same intensity in each and every match. And he is not only going to be the next world's heavyweight champion, but with the signing of this contract, he will be, beyond any doubt in anybody's mind, not only the greatest wrestler ever to come out of the state of Florida, but in my mind, the greatest professional athlete that the state of Florida has ever produced.
Very well said, JJ. And I'd like everybody to know, Gordon, this is a fantastic day. I am so excited. In case you don't know, my lawyer, Mr. Smith, Tom, this is Gordon Sully. I'm
going to
sign this, and let me tell you this here. JJ Dillon has the money, baby. Jim Garvin's got the time, daddy, because let me tell you something. It's been a long time coming. Now I can do whatever I want to do, whenever I want to do it. I have no restrictions, Gordon. It's fantastic. I'm going to go after and lay on the beach, go down to the Hilton and have a few drinks and have a good time. Now let me tell you, Tom here has went over this contract, Gordon Sully. This is the largest money contract ever signed in professional wrestling. He's went through it with a fine-tooth comb. He's covered all the angles. Me and JJ are going to get together, and we're going to show Florida what wrestling's all about. I've been trying to do that for years, but now I'm going to be able to do it with some enjoyment. Isn't that fantastic, Gordon?
Jim, I'm a little amazed. Tom, please, I hope you can shed some light on this.
Gordon, I do want to confirm that I've reviewed this contract, and it's probably the most ironclad contract I've ever reviewed. The money's in escrow. My client is well protected, and this, I think, is a great future for him. I'd also confirm something else. This is probably one of the largest contracts, personal contracts, that I've had the opportunity to review, and he's very well protected.
Well, isn't it fabulous? Is it not fabulous, Gordon Sully? Tell me. It is fabulous, man. It is fabulous. And this is just the beginning.
Gordon Sully, I think one parting comment. I know there are going to be a certain element of the people that may be somewhat shocked, but really, if you think about it logically, you shouldn't be shocked. Reggie Jackson, he was with the New York Yankees, probably the finest organization in professional baseball today. But Reggie Jackson went to Los Angeles. Why did he go to Los Angeles, leave the finest organization in baseball? It's a matter of dollars and cents. That's the bottom line. Pete Rose had a tremendous career in Cincinnati. He went to Philadelphia. The weather's no nicer in Philadelphia than it was in Cincinnati. It's dollars and cents. That's the bottom line. This is the beginning of a new relationship that is going to give Florida a new world heavyweight champion in Jim Garvin. He is the finest athlete you've ever produced, and this should be a proud moment for the wrestling fans, sports fans here in the state of Florida.
Yeah, well, thank you very much, J.J. Dillon. Tom, thank you, and pleasure to see you again.
I'm so happy, Gordon. Are you not happy? You have to tell me. This is exciting. This is the greatest thing that's ever happened.
It's something. There's no question. I will say this, that Jimmy Garvin, with Tom Smith reviewing that contract, I do feel that Jimmy Garvin's interests have been protected to the fullest. I would have to go along with that. Money does talk, doesn't it? Let's go to the ring.
This match, one fall, a 10-minute time limit from Virginia Beach, Virginia, weighing in at 240 pounds, Terry Allen. His opponent from Tucson, Arizona, weighing at 228 pounds, Reggie Park.
Reggie Jackson moving on. Reggie Jackson, listen to that. I'm still thinking about this. I can't get my mind off of this thing. Obviously an extremely lucrative contract that Jim Garvin has signed with J.J. Dillon and Tom Smith. The minute Tom Smith told me that it was the biggest one he'd ever signed, he signed a lot of them, so it has to be big. But it's Reggie Parks against Terry Allen in this match. One fall, 10-minute time limit. Parks, of course, an outstanding athlete. Terry Allen giving away experience here. Weight and size and strength-wise, I would say they are about equal. But when you get down to, in relative terms of wrestling, Buddy Colt, the referee. Buddy Colt, one of the all-time greats in professional wrestling, former North American heavyweight champion. Buddy into a private enterprise now since injuries took him out of the pro ranks in athletics. It is Terry Allen now. Well, I'm dragging twist on Reggie Parks and Allen pressing that advantage. It would be difficult to try and analyze which of these two men has the most stamina, the most endurance. One that I'm looking forward to is a match coming up very shortly. Mr. Ichiban taking on Kendo Nagasaki, and that should be quite a test indeed. But right now, of course, the matter at hand is this match, Reggie Parks against Terry Allen. Reggie Parks, a very smooth competitor. And Parks trying to come out of a situation here. And as he did, there's where the experience paid off. And Parks was able to break free, but Allen moves right back in on him. Good arm drag takedown. Parks set him up. He absolutely set him up. Began with the configuration with the legs, then suddenly swung from that when Allen thought he was doing it purely for leverage. Parks went into the head scissors. So that's where Parks and the experience is playing him such a good hand at this particular point. Allen keeping him tied up there, back into the ropes. The referee, Buddy Cole, calls for the break. Parks behind. Hammerlock. Reversal by Terry Allen. Two men who are exponents of fair play in the sport. Parks trying to set him if he could for a snap mare. Could not get the grip that he wanted. Did not feel secure enough. And obviously did not want to risk the chance of injuring himself. Now approaches this. Good reversal. Another reversal by it. Matching him. matching him extremely well. See what I mean about Parks? Very smooth. Forward somersault into a double leg pickup, now caught in a full body scissors by Terry Allen. Parks trapped with that full body scissors now. Trying to turn that to his own advantage. Goes to a single leg Boston Crab. Then interhooks the leg. And Allen trying to get that leg down flat on the canvas now, as Parks almost had him trapped into a crotch ride. Now Parks caught by Allen as Allen reverses once again. Terry Allen. Old slam by Parks as Allen came off. That youthful exuberance got him in trouble there. And Parks now has him in a backslide. Allen able to roll away from it, but and now it's Allen reversing that, putting a backslide on Parks. Parks was able to get away before the count of three. It is Allen off the rope. Ooh! Ooh! Parks tried a leapfrog, and as he did, hit the head and shoulder of Terry Allen, and Parks went down. Obviously, a hamstring or a thigh muscle problem here, and he cramped as he hit him, I'm sure. What is? Wait a minute. Fine gesture, really a fine gesture. Reggie Parks hurt. It's obvious he cannot continue. The referee informing Terry Allen that he had won, and Terry Allen, from what I could see, shaking it off, saying no, and is more concerned as to the condition of Reggie Parks. So, well, officially or unofficially, let's, for the sake of what appears to be Terry Allen's wishes, let's call this match then a draw, and... Certainly, my personal salute to Terry Allen and his gesture of sportsmanship. We'll be back in just a moment. There you see Kendo Nagasaki in the ring, and along with JJ Dillon, his manager. We're waiting now for the appearance of Mr. Ichiban. And so and you can hear the crowd. There's Nagasaki ready, and wait a minute. Here comes Mr. Ichiban. Let's see if we can get a look at him. Mr. Ichiban, obviously... Wait a minute here. Mr. Ichiban steps into the ring. And Mr. Ichiban... Well... As there is a comment... Certain things must be held self-evident. I think we may... Wait a second. Wait a minute. What's happening here? And it is... Ooh! Ichiban over that top rope. J.J. Dillon. Ichiban had Kendo Nagasaki right over that top rope. Nagasaki trying to get back, and J.J. Dillon pulling him away. J.J. Dillon trying to pull him away from Mr. Ichiban. And J.J. Dillon having to fight for his life to keep Kendo Nagasaki from getting into that ring. Nagasaki wants to go. J.J. Dillon fighting it all away. And Mr. Ichiban stands alone. Mr. Ichiban stands alone in the ring. And it is...
I refuse to be a part of the spectacle. Mr. Ichiban, we all know who he is. This match will not take place. I refuse to be a part of this spectacle.
Well, the victory then, as far as I'm concerned, is right there in the center of the ring. The victor, as far as I'm concerned, his opponent is no longer there, even though the bell never rang and the match never got started. There is Mr. Ichiban. He's going to hold a height and reach advantage on you. But experience-wise, it would appear to me that two of you are about equal, with Southern title on the line.
Well, you know, David Von Erich, without a doubt, has some athletic ability or he wouldn't be here right now. As a matter of fact, I happen to know that he was an all-state football player and an all-state basketball player in Texas, where he grew up. But the fact remains that he's a smart aleck punk. And I hate to say that because I don't like to downgrade anybody, but facts are facts. And David Von Erich, as far as I'm concerned, you better come out there and you better be ready to wrestle. And you start smarting off to me, it's just going to make me a little bit madder. Because I like it when you do that. You get me a little bit mad and you get my blood boiling just a little bit. But the main concern that I'm after is that Southern title, because it's about time that somebody that the people could look up to represent that title. Because all you do is downgrade people, and that isn't right. So you come out there and you be 100%, because I promise you that I will be.
Well, there you have it, the comments from Brian Blair going after David Von Erich this coming Thursday night in the Sunrise Musical Theater. Kendo Nagasaki goes up against Sweet Brown Sugar Thursday night at the Musical Theater as he faces Sweet Brown Sugar. And, well, J.J. Dillon and David Von Erich had some comments.
I'm very excited about coming to Sunrise on Thursday because I will be unveiling Mr. Charisma. I'm talking about the fabulous Jim Garvin. Florida's greatest athlete will be in Sunrise. Now, Kendo Nagasaki will be there, and I'm a little bit worried because with the return of the American Dream, he's got people all pumped up. He's got emotions running high, and he has people like Sweet Brown Sugar thinking that in some way, Kendo Nagasaki, the Black Ninja, is going to take a backward step from another man. Sweet Brown Sugar, Thursday night, the Sunrise Musical Theater, when that bell rings and you see Kendo Nagasaki across the ring, you're going to realize what you're in for, and you're going to be whistling a different tune.
Brian Blair, you no good, low-down, dirty, stinking Florida cracker. I'm a millionaire at 23 years old. I don't need this belt. But I got it because I beat the man fair and square. The way you're going to have to beat David Von Erich fair and square. And all this mumbo jumbo about how you should represent the title is baloney. By the way, Mr. Funk called me from Japan. Hacksaw, he is still the champion. And he's come back to take care of you.
Okay, Hacksaw Butch Reed and Sweet Brown Sugar are with me. Gentlemen, time is short.
Well, you know, Garden Sully, time is drawn at hand. George Funk Jr., Squiggy, you done held that belt long enough. I hear you still got it. But when you come back to Florida, prepare to get your heart broke.
Kendo Nagasaki, Mr. Black Ninja, you meet Mr. Black Soupbone. When we get to Sunrise in Fort Lauderdale, you little bald-haired Japanese guy, you, let me tell you something. We going to play some music, but we going to be playing some soul music. You understand what I'm talking about? It won't be no oriental music. When you come to Sunrise to get sugar, bring your rice and your lunch. It's going to be a long day.
This is a Florida television title match. One fall with a 15-minute time limit. Introducing first from Dallas, Texas, weighing 229 pounds, the Florida television champion, Sweet Brown Sugar. His opponent, also from Dallas, Texas, weighing in at 241 pounds, the Southern heavyweight champion, David Von Erich.
David Von Erich, the Southern heavyweight champion, challenging Sweet Brown Sugar for the Florida TV title. And, of course, this is a television championship match. One fall, 15-minute time limit. David Von Erich removing his garment now, getting set. And Sugar, very anxious for this match. Quite obvious, starts to move in. David Von Erich moving away from him, sliding around. Von Erich stays on that bicycle now. They meet collar and elbow. Von Erich top wrist lock. Von Erich has those long, rangy muscles, and he is indeed a dangerous competitor. Sweet Brown Sugar in the red trunks, to your red and blue trunks. David Von Erich in the black trunks. David Von Erich, second-generation wrestler. Sweet Brown Sugar, the son of a Baptist minister. Outstanding athlete. Wow! Came over his man very nicely. Caught him. High hip toss coming off the ropes. Von Erich utilizes his size so extremely well in the ring. And is one of those men that is so terribly pleased with himself at all times. Comes from a lot of money. Is the first one to admit it. Very wealthy, of course, his dad, Fritz Von Erich. One of the all-time greats in pro wrestling. His two brothers, Kevin and Kerry. Leapfrog by Sweet Brown Sugar. Leapfrogs him again. Caught him that time. Good hip toss takedown. And once again, Sweet Brown Sugar, another good high hip toss. Another hip toss by Sweet Brown Sugar. David Von Erich leaves the ring. And so Sweet Brown Sugar shifting into high gear and moving very effectively against the challenge of David Von Erich. Both men, I might point out, from Texas. Good. Bottom wrist lock, lateral drop, take down into a head scissors by Sweet Brown Sugar. David Von Erich trapped. Referee Tommy Young checking, and Sweet Brown Sugar well within the guidelines and parameters of the rules and regulations, keeping that head scissors on David Von Erich. Sweet Brown Sugar, an interesting study on this man right now. You stop to consider that he has an ally here. Time is his ally. So that he can mix up his match with David Von Erich. He can be offensive and defensive. Von Erich into that rope, and the referee finally calls for the break, and Von Erich back on his posterior over in that far corner, and he's got some problems trying to get his breath back. Sweet Brown Sugar watching him. Von Erich. And watch Von Erich, because he is clever. He'll lull you into a sense of false security if he can. Lashed out with a foot that time. Smash Sweet Brown Sugar. Wow, chopped him across the chest. David Von Erich drives the knee to the midsection. Referee separates him. David Von Erich closes in again. Von Erich caught him that time. Sweet Brown Sugar down to the canvas. Sweet Brown Sugar fires back, and Von Erich now smashed into that turnbuckle. And it is Sweet Brown Sugar. With a high hip toss as Von Erich into party with a beautiful flying drop kick. As Von Erich all but out on his feet, catches him once again. Von Erich trying to get it together now. Sweet Brown Sugar uncorks a 105 howitzer at David Von Erich. And Von Erich has got to be in trouble here. Sugar gas him up once again. The Florida TV title on the line. And Von Erich ripped him up that time. He got the count of three. He got the count of three. But his feet were on the ropes. The referee couldn't see it, but his feet were on the ropes. That will go for review, I'm sure. But nonetheless, David Von Erich has the three count on Sweet Brown Sugar. And you can see the crowd at ringside here protesting that Von Erich was on the ring ropes, and it will be reviewed, I can assure you of that. But at the moment, as it stands, David Von Erich has just acquired, and I will not say won, he has just acquired the Florida TV title. We'll be back to Barbara's Take 5 in a moment.
This week's Take 5, we're dealing with something very interesting. It's a softball game to benefit the Town and Country Youth League. With me are members of the Tampa Bay Bucs football team, the Central Division champions, also Ann Grayson, the coordinator of the game, and some of the wrestlers. Let me introduce first the members of the football team. Next to me is Frank Capello, the manager, also known as the American Nightmare, Mr. Football, who prefers to remain nameless, Cecil Johnson, a linebacker, and James Wilder, running back. The wrestlers with me are Hacksaw Reed, Mr. Wrestling 2, and Terry Allen. First, I will let Mr. Papello talk.
Well, you know, a couple of years ago, I had a game against the wrestlers. Toward the end of the game, said they had to go. Said they had a wrestling match somewhere. They were winning at the time. We didn't think that was quite right. This year, we want to go the full distance. We ain't gonna cut early. We're gonna be there. It's for charity. I know it's for charity. We're gonna be there. We're gonna win. Cecil, you got something?
I want the American dream, baby. Tell him I want him. When he get ready, just tell him to come on out there. I don't even want to see all these. Who that is, Hexaw, who, and Tarzan. I don't want to see them. I want to see the American dream. That's what I want to see.
That's right.
Well, I believe the wrestlers have something to say to that.
Well, you understand, Barbara? This softball game is going to be a real good game. Going to be better than the game before. And my man Cecil over there talking about he don't want to see us. Well, he going to see a whole lot of us. And I hope he got on his track shoes because we're going to be sending some balls.
Mr. Wrestling 2, you have something to say also?
Well, he said it just about the way it should be said. You know, the fellow over there with the mask, he's kind of got a twitch over there. He's already nervous. We haven't got on the field yet. But nevertheless, it's all going to come down. It's going to come down right.
And it's going to come down at Al Lopez Field in Tampa Sunday at 3:30. It's going to be an exciting day, and it is for charity.
Jim Garvin moving out against Bob Russell. One fall, television time remaining. And waiting now for that bell to ring. It is rung, and it is... It'll be interesting to see how Garvin... what sort of... Wow! Caught him with a beautiful drop kick coming off the ropes. Garvin up. Another beautiful drop kick, and Russell shaking his head. He's trying to get it together. Garvin has a beautiful, beautiful belly-to-back suplex on Russell. Garvin closes in. They count of three. A count of three. And, boy, you talk about intensity. Garvin has got it. There's no question about that. And an obviously very jubilant J.J. Dillon. We do have a standby man.
Fantastic, my man. Didn't even break the sweat. Easy money. Easy money.
The things to come.
Well, we've got a standby match coming up.
What's
need to have that.
Match?
Well, I've got Chris Markoff, Hiro Matsuda.
Wait a minute. Just stop everything right here. If you're going to have a standby match, I don't want this day to be spoiled with the contract signing, this marvelous victory on the part of Jim Garvin, and then to have what everybody knows is Dusty Rhodes come out here with another charade trying to embarrass me. Wait a minute. Let's stop before this match starts. Kendo, Dozo, Hayaku, Andre, I'm going to pull that suit of Mark off out of here. I'm sending Garvin. I'm sending Kendo right here. This is my day of glory.
All right, so I don't know whether, well, let's see what happens here. We've got a standby situation. And sure enough, he is sending Garvin out there and Kendo Nagasaki to move out against El Grande Apollo and Bubba Douglas. Okay, so this is our standby match. And moving right into it, El Grande Apollo and Jim Garvin. Garvin, he's right, he really didn't, that was a very, very short match indeed as he wiped out Bob Russell. He brought him with a pair of extremely well-executed flying drop kicks into that, into a belly-to-back suplex, and had Russell down for that count of three. But now you've got El Grande Apollo out there. El Grande Apollo up and over his man, Garvin. Catches him coming in, full body slam. And Apollo moves now with a good arm drag takedown. Both men back on their feet. An arm drag takedown by Jim Garvin. Apollo went for the head scissors, broken up. And you could see Garvin and Apollo now. Top wrist lock broken up, and it's Apollo in behind this man. Rolling reverse, he's got him. One, two, no sir. Kendo Nagasaki breaking it up, and Bubba Douglas is in there. Bubba Douglas in there, and it is Kendo Nagasaki beginning to wipe out everybody in sight using those chops so very effectively. And he has a deadly effectiveness with those chops. Nagasaki pounding away now at Bubba Douglas, catches him, and... Boy, you talk about action. We've got it here. Nagasaki catches him at the belt line. And it is Nagasaki continuing to hammer and pummel away at Bubba Douglas. Referee Buddy Gold. Once again, trying to give Bubba Douglas some time and some room. And it is Apollo and Garvin outside the ring. Wait a second. Wait a minute. The American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, just hit the ring. The American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, just hit the ring. And now, Dusty Rhodes trying to even up the odds here. And it is Dusty Rhodes standing tall there now. And Nagasaki, Garvin, and J.J. Dillon, who is the cooler head of the three. J.J. Dillon pulling him off. And again, Nagasaki tries to charge in there. And Nagasaki doesn't fear anyone. But, well, we've got... our time is gone. We'll see you next week.